والحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد الشاكرين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي السلام عليكم ورحمه الله يا برز I ask Allah عز وجل we pray all of us that we may accept our fasting our prayer our qiyam and our siyam and the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one hadith says man qara ramadan إيمانا واحتسابا وغفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever stands up in the month of Ramadan, إيمانا واحتسابا for the إيمان of Allah عز وجل, believing in Allah. And احتساب means he is accounting for this for his deeds to be rewarded by Allah عز وجل. Whoever does that, then Allah عز وجل vows to forgive his previous sins. غَفَرَ لَهُ مَا تَقَدَّمَ مِنْ ذَنْبِهِ May Allah Azza wa Jal make us among those whose sins are being deleted and being forgiven by Allah Azza wa Jal. That is the best we can achieve in this month. Now, as the brother was mentioning, in Ramadan there are values. In everything that we do there are values. And if we do things and we do not pinpoint on the value in the thing that we do, probably we'll be just doing things as robots. In fact, there is a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that alludes to this, that so many people who fast, that they get nothing out of their fast but being hungry and thirsty. So many people who fast, like someone who will fast and he will be quarreling with people, he will be using bad words, he will be insulting, he will be nervous, he will be angry, he will be doing all types of nasty things. He doesn't get anything out of the fast. What is it that you get out of the fast that the Prophet ﷺ wants us to get? There are things that we should be looking for. And here we are saying that there are certain values. One of these values, the first one which I will be talking about, is this issue which is related to the Quran. And again, the one who defines the values is not me. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He is the one who makes Ramadan, He is the one who ordains the Siyam, and therefore He is the one who says, this is what I want you to get out of the of this month. And the first thing I chose to talk about is, this is the month of the Quran. So the greatest supreme value of the month of Ramadan is the fact that the Quran was revealed in this. And Allah Azza wa Jalla, when He says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, after he talks about siyam, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْهُمُ الصِّيَامُ Siyam has been prescribed upon you. Then the next ayah, he says, شَهْرُ رَمَضَانُ الَّذِي أُنزِلَ فِيهِ الْقُرْآنِ The month of Ramadan is the month in which the Quran is revealed. So here is an identification. Sometimes you want to define something. You would say, define for me, for example, the city of Chicago. You say the city of Chicago is the city in which there is the skyline, the Sears building. So in this case, you characterize a city with the best thing you can think of, the thing that is so famous, so well known. You need to characterize that. When you want to characterize a person, you say that person is a person who talks loud, or a person who speaks fast, or a person who is too smart. So you want to characterize something with the best or with the most visible. Allah Azza wa Jalla is characterizing the month of the month of Ramadan. He doesn't say this is the month of jihad, for example, although Ramadan is the month of jihad. He doesn't say this is the month of fasting, although it is the month of fasting, or the month of qiyam. It is the month of qiyam. He chooses, Allah Azza wa Jalla, to define Ramadan with the Quran. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن It is the month in which the Quran is revealed. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla chooses certain characteristics of the Quran. So first, for Ramadan He says it's the month in which the Quran is revealed. Which is true, the Quran is revealed in Ramadan. And we know that, in fact, Allah Azza wa Jalla talks about ليلة القدر إِنَّا أَنزَلْنَاهُ فِي لَيْلَةِ الْقَدْرِ So He revealed the Quran in the month of Ramadan and in particular in the night of Mayl, the night of Al-Qadr, which we will talk about inshallah later in other sessions. But he Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, the month of Ramadan is the month in which the Quran is revealed, and again he chooses for the Quran certain characteristics. Now the Quran, Allah Azza wa Jalla defines it in many different places. It is shifa, it is rahmah, it has the qasas, the stories. It is something that Allah Azza wa Jalla talks about in many, many different places. But in this location, in this ayah, Allah Azza wa Jalla chooses شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن وهدى للناس. It is guidance for all mankind. Guidance for all mankind. وبينات من الهدى. And details of guidance. وبينات من الهدى والفرقان. فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصوم. Then he continues, whoever witnesses the month of Ramadan, then he should fast. So here's the focus. That in this ayah, Allah Azza wa Jalla provides the supreme value of Ramadan. This is the month of the Quran. And out of the Quran, it is the Quran of the guidance. So what do we get out of this? So Ramadan comes a week earlier, and 3 weeks from now it will be gone. We have this 4 weeks plus couple of days of Ramadan. If we do not catch the fact that in this month there is something about guidance for all mankind, and there is details of guidance, then we did not get it. Then we will just get hungry and thirsty and leave, just being dying to get a bottle of water at the end of the day, or to eat some food at sunset. That's not the essence of Ramadan. The essence here, we've got to realize that this month is famous for something important. It's important for this thing. And this thing that's important, that makes Ramadan so famous, is not because it's a book that we read when somebody dies, funeral, or we read in Taraweeh, we finish it, we complete it, or everyone of us will say, how many khidmah you made in Ramadan? I made one, you made two, you made three, so we make competitions. That's fine, that's good, but Allah Azza wa Jal is telling us that is not the issue. The issue is that this Quran that was revealed in Ramadan contains guidance. For whom? This guidance, al-huda, because quite often we talk about al-huda, what does huda? What is it when we say there is a guidance? Guidance for what? What time do you need guidance? Many of us here, they have the GPS, right, the navigator. Quite often we say, I'll give you an address. You have a navigator, so the navigator will guide you. What does that mean? It means it takes you in specific directions, step by step, to lead you to a destination. That is guidance. When you go, you want to study. You first finish your high school, you want to go to college. So you go to a supervisor, someone who's going to advise you. This advisor, he will give you a curriculum. This is what you are going to study in order to get your degree. That is guidance. You need some specific guidelines, some specific activities, some actions that will take you from A to B. That will take you from one position to another position. And when do you need that? You need guidance, especially when things become so vague, they are not well understood, you have problems, you have certain crises, you don't know how to get out of that, so you need guidance. Now, when Allah Azza wa Jalla says Al-Quran is guidance for all mankind, for first hudan lin-nas, this is number one, hudan lin-nas, it means that people in general, they do require guidance. Guidance for what? Guidance on how to live. Guidance on how to deal with their money. Guidance on how to deal with their finances. We talked about the economic system a few weeks ago here in this masjid. They need guidance on how to interact men and women. Whether to get married, whether to have boyfriends, girlfriends, gays, lesbians, all these issues, similar marriages, what they call them, the same-sex marriage, etc. They need guidance on that. What's right, what's wrong? What's good, what's bad? What can be done, what cannot be done? Who's going to consult? Who's going to tell us what is the way out? And when people start facing political crises, like the ones which are happening in the Middle East now, in Syria, in Libya, and other places, there are all types of chaos, chaotic things. You need guidance. When people they get indulged in certain activities And at some point, they find themselves they are bankrupt. Bankrupt of ideas, bankrupt of systems, bankrupt of laws, of regulations. They need guidance. So Allah Azza wa Jalla says, in this month of Ramadan, I gave a Quran, I revealed a Quran, in which there is guidance for all people. Not necessarily Muslims. Now, how do you get a guidance from the Quran? Ah, the next ayah says, بَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَى. So now you need details. At the beginning, in general, the Quran, and of course, with the Quran goes the Sunnah, which means Islam, because the Quran is Islam. Quran is Islam. Quran is the core of Islam. So when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, the Quran, Huda lin-nas, means this Islam that He revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which at the core of which is the Quran, and what comes with the explanation of the Quran from the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that's Islam. So the people, in general, they do need Islam to be guided. If we don't get this out of our reading of the Quran from this month of Ramadan, we do not understand this fact, that means we are missing a great value. That this Quran and this Islam is supposed to be a revelation for people to be guided with. Now, that's very general. Without even going in detail, Islam, because it's revealed from Allah Azza wa Jalla, because Allah Azza wa Jalla is the God, because He is the Creator, because He is the one who is most knowledgeable, because He knows the past and the present and the future, because He is the one who created man, He created life, He created universe, He created water, He created food, He did all of these, therefore guidance is from Him, goes without any question. That's at the general level. Now, with the details, the ayah says, وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَى. What does بَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَى mean? بَيِّنَات means details. Now, the details comes in, says, what details you are talking? And بَيِّنَات means everything that is needs further explanation. Everything needs to be detailed. We say, Allah Azza wa Jal is my God, He's my Creator. He guides me to what is good. What is it that He guides me to? Prayer. How do you pray? That's guidance, that's details. How do you fast? That's details. How do you invest your money? That's detail. You cannot invest with riba. That's detail. You cannot do zina, but you can do marriage. That's details. You cannot lie. That's details. You cannot make shahadat zur, false witness. That is details. All these are details. The details which have to do with the sales. What is it that you can sell? What you cannot sell? Whenever you make a sale, what is a valid contract? What's invalid contract? When you want to make a lease, what's a valid lease? What's invalid lease? When you have a problem between people, how do you dissolve disputes? What ways you dissolve a dispute between two people? The qada, the judicial system, that is details. So Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed all these details, and with these details, He ordered Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the people behind him, after him, to rule and to use the details that Allah Azza wa Jalla revealed for guidance and for ruling. وَنَحْكُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَهُمْ. Rule them with whatever Allah Azza wa Jalla has revealed. That is details of guidance. And then he says al-furqan. So there are three things here. هُدَى لِلنَّاسِ, guidance for all mankind in general, because Allah Azza wa Jalla is the God, He is the Creator, He is the Rabb, He is the Lord. Therefore, He is the one who is supposed to provide guidance, and the guidance doesn't come from anyone else but Allah Azza wa Jalla. And then there are the details which are summarized in systems. Sometimes we say it's a political system, the social system, the economic system, the punitive system, the value system, all of these systems, when you put them together, those are the details. And then the last thing is al-furqan. Al-Furqan. Al-Furqan, and here comes very interesting thing. Al-Furqan means something is a splitter. The word faraqa means split. There is a split between two things. Al-Quran is a splitter. It's the one that splits between haqq and batil, between false and truth and truthfulness, between what is right, between what is wrong, between what is good, what is bad. Quite often the people, their major dispute, anytime you have a dispute or argument or something, it is on the definition. What is your definition of what is good or what is bad? What is right or what's wrong? What should be done, what should not be done? Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Al-Quran is the Furqan. Is the Furqan, is the one that makes this distinction. That makes this decisive distinction between what is haqq and what's batil. Although some of the mufassirin, they'll talk about the distinction or al-fuqal even in war. Like Allah Azza wa Jalla called the battle of Badr, the battle of al-fuqal. يوم التقى الجمعان يوم الفرقان يوم التقى الجمعان. The فرقان, whenever there is a battle, there is a war in which the victory is for Islam against the kufr, that's فرقان. And Al-Quran in general now, it is just like a decisive war. It is the one that tells, that splits things on the right and on the left. Quite often, if anybody has watched the House of Commons in Britain, they have two locations. One for the left and one for the right. One for the ruling party and one for the other party. And there's a line that splits between them. Because these are two distinct groups of people. It is not that imaginary line. It is the real line of the Quran. So whenever we want to see what is the difference, what is the difference between me and others? What's the difference between Islam and Kufr? What's the difference between right and wrong? What's the difference between haqq and batil and so on? Then the Quran is the one that defines that. If we don't get this value, when we read the Quran, when we go through the tarawiyah, when we make the khidmah once or twice or three times, when we do that and we don't get out of it, that this is something that really separates things. Separates things on two sides totally. There is no gray area between iman and kufr. There is no gray area. In fact, when the brother was reading in Tarawih, when he talks in Surah Tawbah, when Allah Azza wa Jalla says, "Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la tattakhidu aba'akum wa ikhwanakum awliya in istahabbu al-iman in istahabbu al-kufr 'ala al-iman." Oh, you who believe, if your parents or brothers, look at this, parents or brothers, he's not talking about neighbors. Your parents, your father, or your mother, or your brother, if they prefer iman over kufr, if they prefer kufr over iman, do not align yourself with them. Split. That's fuqan, there's a split. He's talking about a split, an ideological split, a spiritual split, a value split. It is not physical split. It is not the fact that I'm not going to support my father with money. No, I will continue to support my father, despite he could be, just the example, could be a kafir or could be against Islam. And not necessarily being a person who is denying Islam. In the Muslim world, and many of you have examples where you find in the same family a person who is a pro-Islam, he wants the implementation of Islam, and another person is so-called leftist, socialist. He wants socialism in the same family. You'll have someone who is communist, who believes in communism and he thinks communism is good, or capitalism or democracy for that matter. Democracy means the rule of people. And the other person, the brother or the son or the father, he believes in the rule of Allah Azza wa Jalla. These are two distinct entities. And the Quran is making a split. He says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, La tattakhidu aba'akum wa ikhwanakum awliya. إن استحبوا الكفر على الإيمان. If they prefer kufr over iman, they cannot be realized. There is a split, there is a furqan. Those are the details of the furqan. In the same surah, later on Allah Azza wa Jalla says, قل إن كان آباؤكم وإخوانكم وأزواجكم وعشيرتكم وأموال اقترفتموها وتجارة تخشون كسادها أحب إليكم من الله ورسوله فتربصوا. Now, if you prefer over the love of Allah and His Messenger, your parents, your children, your brothers, your wives, your tribe, many of us come from tribal societies. Oh, the tribe is, if my tribe says something, I will follow the tribe. The Quran here is a splitter. It says you cannot follow your tribe if your tribe is wrong, and not according to the Quran. So these values, which I call them, these are the supreme. These are the highest values. When somebody says it's a supreme value, like Supreme Court, beyond which there is no rule. A supreme value, it's a value beyond which you don't seek other values. Once you get this in the brain, in your mind, and in your heart, that Al-Quran and Islam is guidance for all mankind. Al-Quran contains details of guidance for me, and the Quran is the only thing that allows me to split with others. The splitter, the fuqal, is the Quran. That is the first thing which we should get in this month of Ramadan about this Quran that we are reading. And if we go through Ramadan and we read this Quran and we go through all these tarawiyahs and we don't get these values, that means we missed the main thing. We missed it. Sometimes you miss something. You read, or you are reading a text, you say, you know, there's an idea, I missed it. I'm glad you reminded me. And we know when we miss something. So I hope and pray to Allah Azza wa Jalla that this month, like every month of Ramadan, we get this reminder and we go back to this Quran and realize and visualize it and within ourselves, inculcate it within ourselves with all of these supreme values of guidance for all mankind, with details of guidance and with the Quran. Again, here from the ayat about the siyam, where Allah Azza wa Jalla prescribed a siyam, He specifically gave the reason or the objective, not the reason, because there is a difference between the reason or the objective. The objective is what is expected from you to achieve after you fast. The reason is from Allah. Why He prescribed a siyam? He is the one who does that. He did not say why. But what is it that He wants out of the siyam? What we have to get out, He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا or who you believe, كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ. Siyam has been prescribed unto you, كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ, just like it was prescribed for people before you, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so you may acquire a taqwa. That's the objective, for specifically for a siyam. We said for the month of Ramadan in general, in the previous session, it was about the Quran. So remember, this month of Ramadan is associated with the Quran. As-Siyam, the act of Siyam that we do from dawn until sunset, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so you may acquire taqwa. Now, a taqwa, if you come to think about it, go to the pure linguistic meaning, just the Arabic meaning. What is a taqwa? Taqwa, when you say it is a derivative from the verb taqa or waqa. Taqa or waqa means you avoid. Let's say you are walking something in a path and then there is a stone, there is a rock, you want to avoid it. Ittaqi, you say, beware. Beware, there is a rock. Beware, there is a hole. Beware, there is a bomb. Beware, there is something that's bad. That's something that can hurt you. So a taqwa is to have this internal awareness. So beware of something. Be alert. This alertness, this awareness. And this awareness is from the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal is there always, and He can see you, and He can hear you, and He can watch you, and He can hold you accountable. So beware. In the outside the scope of Islam, the people have invented the term conscience. Sometimes they say, oh, you don't have a conscience. You steal something, you don't care about this, your conscience is dead. So they have this word conscience, this internal feeling, internal alertness about something that you are a good, nice person. But Allah Azza wa Jalla brought the concept of taqwa, which is alertness and awareness of the fact that Allah Azza wa Jalla, God the Creator, the Supreme, the Almighty, He is the All-Knowledgeable, He is always there, He is watching, He sees you, He can hear what you say, and He can acquire all the knowledge about you, so that beware of doing anything that can upset Allah Azza wa Jalla. That is the essence of taqwa. The essence is build that internal characteristic. And when we talk about building something within, quite often people have, they go to psychiatrists. They spend thousands or millions of dollars in order to fix one trait, one characteristic, one property of the human. If you have a problem, you are too sad, you are absolutely irregular, you are abnormal, you cannot handle your daily job. You go and you spend all types of money, to people to build certain characteristics. But here Allah Azza wa Jalla says, the highest value, the highest characteristic a person can acquire from which he can resolve so many other issues is a taqwa. A taqwa is to be watchful of Allah Azza wa Jalla all the time. If you want to think even aggressively or negatively or badly or to be in a mood that is not good mood, you remember that Allah Azza wa Jalla, taqwa helps you to say, oh, Allah Azza wa Jalla is there and He can save me. Allah Azza wa Jalla is there, He can help me. Allah Azza wa Jalla is there, He can watch me. Allah Azza wa Jalla is there, He can hold me accountable. So this taqwa, to build it in someone, is not something easy. That's not something that, oh, I want to be muttaqi. Just like that. Because to have this continuous ability, this ability to continuously be alert to Allah Azza wa Jal, that's not that simple. So Allah says, I prescribe a siyam so that you may be able to attain a taqwa. So this is one way of attaining a taqwa. And one very well defined way through the entire month. And let's think about it. Let's think about it. And the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talks about it in a different manner. It says, كُلُّ عَمَلِ بْنِ آدَمْ لَا إِلَّا صَنْفَ وَلِي وَأَنَا أَنْزِلِي. All the deeds that you do are yours, but الصَّنْف is mine, Allah Azza wa Jalla says. Allah, الصَّنْف is mine. Fasting is mine. How? Well, we just prayed here. Anyone who had walked from outside, he would have seen us praying. And maybe a person was sitting with the chair not praying. He would say, oh, this person is not praying. Maybe he is not a Muslim, or maybe he has prayed before. But he knows. You pray, you go to Hajj. Everybody goes and sees. Oh, this brother has been to Hajj. I've seen him there. You pay zakah. Zakah has to reach somebody. Although you get it out of your pocket, you are the only one who knows how much. But at the end of the day, your zakah reaches some people. It has to go through someone. So somebody knows about zakah. The only thing that you are the only one who knows about it is the salah. Nobody knows when he walks out of the walks in the masjid during the daytime, although we are all praying, nobody knows who is fasting and who is not fasting. The only one who knows is you. In fact, if you really come to be a bit more detailed here, the only one who knows you are fasting is Allah Azza wa Jalla. It's not even you. You don't even know whether you are still fasting or not. Because as the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, كَمْ مِنْ صَائِمًا لَيْسَ لَهُمْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعُ وَالْعَطَشُ. How many people who are fasting, they get out of their fasting nothing but hunger or thirst. So actually they are being thirsty and hungry, they are not fasting. Who knows that? Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah knows whether the act you have done, the behavior you have gone into, a lie you have made, a mistake you have done, it has eliminated your fasting. So a psalm, the only one who knows about a psalm is Allah Azza wa Jalla. So in order for your psalm to be accepted, in order for your psalm to be really valid, you have to be very watchful. You have to be alert from within and to be very careful of what you do. If anybody even tries to push you aside or insult you or aggravate you, Allahumma inni sa'im. Just beware, Allahumma inni sa'im. I'm not going to waste my siyam. That type of practice is a practice of building taqwa. That is a practice of building taqwa. Nothing more than siyam can build taqwa in the human. Nothing more. Fighting al jihad can teach you how to make sabr, patience. But patience is not taqwa. Patience requires taqwa. As-salat can teach you how to stay away from al-munkar. Inna as-salata tanha an fahsha'i wal munkar. The Quran says, as-salat tanha an fahsha'i wal munkar. As-salat allows you to stay away from fahsha, the bad things, or al-munkar, or the wrong deeds. But as-salat is more than that. As-salat gives you the taqwa that keeps you away from munkar and fahsha. As-salat builds the taqwa that allows you to stay away from the bad things. Now, why do I need taqwa? Well, read Surah Al-Baqarah, if you will. At the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, when Allah Azza wa Jalla talks about the guidance, going back to our previous session, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ. This book indeed has guidance for all mankind. That's what we talked about in the previous session. ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ.
هُدًى للناس أَلَفْ لَا مِنْ ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِي هُدًى لِلنَّاسِ الَّذِينَ هُدًى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون. So the first characteristic required for getting the guidance from here is التقوى. هدى للمتقين. So التقوى, going back now, Ramadan is a month of the Quran. The Quran is the book of guidance. And the guidance can be attained by muttaqin. And the taqwa is achieved through a salt. So try to build this circle or to build these links. You find them like pieces or blocks which are built on top of each other. And they rhyme, they go, they flow. So a salt here, which is the second value we're talking about, is meant to build that taqwa. And that taqwa allows you to acquire that guidance. And that guidance, which is revealed in the Quran, and that Quran, which is that guidance which is contained in the Quran, and that Quran which is revealed in Ramadan. So this supreme value of taqwa we cannot miss. Going back to, if I go through Ramadan again, Ramadan comes in, it's already a week, still have 3 more weeks. 4 weeks after that, if I have a person whose taqwa has not been improved, who has not attained a taqwa, who has not been able to build that taqwa characteristic within me, that means I have missed the value of Ramadan or the value of Siyam. That means the Siyam, I have done my Siyam, alhamdulillah, I'm not going to be accountable to repeat my Siyam. So it's not as if I missed my Salt, but I missed the objective of the Salt. I could not get the outcome of the Salt. I could not get the gist out of it. So the gist of the Salt, the inner core or juice of it, which I would like to get out of that, is to build the taqwa trait, taqwa characteristic within me. And that's what we should, when we take our children, our sons, our younger ones with us, in the month of Ramadan, we go through them, we wake them up at the sahur time, they make the sahur, they pray fajr, and they start the siyam, and they go through that, and they get hungry, and they get thirsty, and then all of these day after day, month after month, year after year, we have to make sure that we build or we direct their attention and our attention also as adults, because we probably have missed that when we were children, when we were young, that we have to make sure that this taqwa to Allah Azza wa Jalla is built, not only during Ramadan, but for the year after. Remember that this month of Ramadan comes only 1 month, so it stays with you all the way to the next year. So it should be at least sufficient for the year to come, for a whole year, that you will be alert from within, aware of the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal is watchful and can hold you accountable, and that He sees all your acts and He watches for your acts. Therefore, you better line up your activities, your behavior, your actions, your thoughts, your minds, your heart, your feelings, your emotions, all with what Allah Azza wa Jal has recommended. All of whatever Allah Azza wa Jal has ordained. That is the result of taqwa. Because why do I need the taqwa? Because I need the guidance. Why do I need the guidance? Because I need to abide by it. I need to be guided. I need my behavior to go according to Islam, according to the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal. I need to have all my life consistent with this creation of Allah Azza wa Jal. I want to be a person who is created just like Allah Azza wa Jal created the stars, the moons, the earth, everything. I am one of those creatures that abide naturally by the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal. That I become consistent with this whole essence of creation of Allah Azza wa Jal. I will not be someone who is on, someone who is against the rules of creation. I'm not going to say the rules of nature, as people of physics say, but these are the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal has created everything in harmony. So I better be in harmony with all the universe, harmony with myself, harmony with the people, harmony with the laws of Allah Azza wa Jal, harmony with this essence of the fact that I will be, on the day of judgment, will be accounted for all my deeds. All this harmonious life, it has to be created out of this taqwa. So that siyam, whenever I start my day for Ramadan, for siyam, and end that day, I always have to look within myself.
my taqwa I have done? Or am I still the same? Or I could not even feel it? Or I'm not getting it? Then you have to work on it. Because that doesn't come natural. It doesn't come simply because you fast, you get the taqwa. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla says the word la'allakum taqwa. And it says la'alla, says you may become muttaqin. Because this word maybe or la'allakum maybe gives the indication that it is something that you have to be aware of, something you have to act on. It is not automatic. So he doesn't say kutib alaykum as-siyam and you will be muttaqin. You will fast and then you will become muttaqin. No. He says you fast, I prescribe upon your fasting, so you may become muttaqin. And this word may become or you may acquire taqwa, it implies that it is something you have to work on, something you have to be aware of, something you have to explicitly think of, so that you can feel it, you can touch it, you can understand, you can inculcate it, so you can know, you can tell that your taqwa now is better, is stronger, or at least you have.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
I chose this name, structural value, and I suspect that many of you probably wouldn't even have a clue what I'm going to talk about. Does anybody know what type of structural value that I'm referring to here? What do I mean by that? Anybody has a thought? Yeah.
Structure of values, but maybe you are going to talk about how the values are interconnected with each other.
How is what?
How values are interconnected. How values are linked to each other.
Okay,
they are separated.
That's a close. Close. Yeah. That's a close enough. But it's not accurate. Anyone else would have?
They are dependent on each other?
That's what he just said. They are dependent on each other.
Composition?
Composition, but what when we do say structure, what does structure mean? Structure. This house is a structure, correct? It's a bina. It's a house. It's a structure. And the reason now I got this word from the hadith with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The hadith it says, "Muniya Islam wa ala khas." Islam is a structure upon. Bina is a structure, it's a building. It is built upon. Islam, and this hadith, everybody knows it. And this is probably one of the first hadiths we teach our kids with. Bunya Islam wa al-Khams, right? I'm pretty sure, I know that everybody, the schools, this is the first hadith they teach it in schools, in religious classes, in Islamic classes. Bunya Islam wa al-Khams. Islam is structured upon five. There are five things upon which Islam is built. So the hadith is talking about a structure. It's talking about a building. It's talking about a house. And the foundation and the pillars of this house are five. One is shahadatu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadur Rasulullah. And I call this the foundation, which is aqidah, that's the iman. And then there are four other things. Iqam al-salah. إِتَاءُ الزَّكَاةِ حَجُّ الْبَيْتِ وَصَوْمُ رَمَضَانِ. Those four, I would say there is a foundation. This building means a foundation. And then there are pillars. Because the building will not stand in a vacuum. The building does not stand in a vacuum. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is summarizing this Islam for us and this building of Islam. He is making this beautiful summary. He says there is a structure which is called Islam, and this Islam has a foundation and has four pillars. One of them is As-Sawm. So As-Sawm Ramadan, one of the values of the Sawm, one of the significance of the Sawm, one of the things that we have to capture in our mind is that it's a pillar for a building. It's a pillar upon which a building is built. So that's where I get this word structural value. It's the value that allows us to understand the structure of Islam. To understand that Islam is a structure. Now, what is the structure? Because quite often we get indulged
with the pillar itself, with the salah, with the salah, with the zakah, with the hajj. And everybody is indulged in this. And sometimes we think that this is Islam, this is all Islam is this. In fact, I've heard sometimes some people, they call and quote, they have a title of a scholar, because sometimes I really don't like to hear to say a scholar, but some people, they have a title, which means a degree that gives them the title of a scholar. So they get the turban, they get the jubba, and they have a certificate, and so they become. So what some of these people, they even quote some hadiths, they use some hadiths to indicate that this is Islam. If you do your salah, your song, your zakat, your hajj, that's it, you are done. But this hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Buniya Islam," it says that Islam, the structure of Islam is something else. So those are the foundation and the pillars. But what is Islam? Where is the abidance not doing zina? Where is the rules about lying? Where is the rules about not eating money which is consumed by haram? Where are the rules that have to do with the false witness, the zoor? Where are the rules which have to do with fighting Muslims or not killing a Muslim or not killing innocent people? Where are the rules that have to do with all types of investments? Where are the rules which have to do with being nice to your neighbors? Where are the rules which have to do with your governance, who's going to govern you and the shura? They are all these rules that have to do with Islam. Those are not prayer and fasting and hajj and zakat. Those are the daily things that we do all the time between the prayers. You pray five times a day. Each time probably no more than 5 minutes. And your daytime is about 24 hours. So if you multiply 5 by 25, that's 75 minutes, that's 1 hour and 15 minutes, correct? Now you sleep probably, let's say, 6 hours. So take a total of 7-8 hours. You have 24 minus 8 hours, you have 16 hours. Do you do what? Isn't that where Islam is? Isn't that where your Islamic life is within these 16 hours? Between Ramadan and Ramadan, you have a whole year, 11 months, you are not fasted. You are fasted 1 month, as-siyam. And you are doing zakah once a year. You are getting 2.5% of your money, but the rest of your money, let's say if your zakah is 1,000 dirhams, so your money is what? About 40,000 dirhams? If you get 1,000 dirhams zakah, so you have 39,000 dirhams left. What are you doing with this 39,000 dirhams? You give zakah 1,000, you still have 39K. So doesn't Islam have to do with this money? Of course it does. And the same thing goes for Hajj. So here, this structural value, we have to understand that a salam has come in order to build a house and to maintain it. A salam has come to build, just like a salah and a zakah and a hajj, they have come to raise up a building called Islam. They have come to hold this building of Islam intact. But if you don't have the building at all, what good does your pillar do to you? Have you seen a person or any family or even refugees like the ones are evicted from Syria? Do you think they would live in a tent with pillars only? Just they go to Turkey or to Jordan and then here comes the United Nations, they give them 4 pillars and they say, here, go and live there. Do you think they would accept that? Of course not. Do you think anyone in his right mind, anyone of us here, will build a home, will go and work and get some money, and then go and get some support, and have a house that has 4 or 10 or 15 pillars? So subhanAllah, this house, there could be a bathroom here, there could be a bedroom there, there could be, but it is not there. Can you live in that? You cannot. Now, we have been living only with pillars of Islam for so many years. For so many years, the Muslim Ummah has been living in the pillars of Islam. And if you tell any of these Muslims, any person, why don't you live in a house only with pillars? You'll say, I'm not crazy to do that. Are you crazy? You want me to live with a house without a ceiling, a house without walls, a house with walls without windows, a house without door, a house without furniture, a house without lighting, a house without piping, a house without sewage, without water, without electricity? It's impossible. I can't do that. Nobody in his right mind does that. But we in the Muslim Ummah, we have been living with Islam using only the prayers. And we are happy about it. And we are absolutely happy. Ramadan comes, we are so happy. We indulge in fasting, and we are just like we are doing now. With Qiyam, with Taraweeh, with Psalm, with the food, with the invitations. I mean, we are absolutely obsessed with this. But we don't have our building. We don't have the building of Islam. We don't have the systems of Islam. We don't have the ceiling that covers us. Now, what is the ceiling? Well, there's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It says, "Al-imam junna yuqatil murayhi wa yuttaqa bihi." The imam is a shield. The imam of the Muslim is a shield. He is the one who protects this ummah, and he is the one who gives this. He's like the actual shield. When somebody shoots at you, you can protect yourself. That's just like a ceiling for a house. You don't have a ceiling, the sun will pour on you, the water will pour on you, the rain will pour on you, and you spoil everything, all parts of your life. You don't have a junna. You don't have a shield. You don't have a shield. The walls, the ones that keep you Islam, I would look at them as your social system, the system that organizes the life between men and women in a nice manner. The system that provides the women with their proper clothing of Islam. The system that provides the natural separation so that men and women do not intermingle in a manner that will provide corruption. A system that will allow the people for their divorce and marriage, for their divorce rate to go down and their marriage rate to go up. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, يَا مَعْشَرَ الشَّبَابِ مَنْ اسْتَطَاعَ مِنْكُمُ الْبَاءَ فَلْيَتَزَوَّجْ. Oh, young men, whoever has the capability to get married, so let them get married. And if you don't have the capability, the state and the zakah will pay you so that you have the capability, so that you can get married, so that you don't go and fool around and don't leave those young women just floating around without finding someone to marry them. This is a social system. It's a wall that builds, that surrounds you. And then the political system. You don't have a political system. Just like we don't have, what is a political system in Islam? A political system in Islam is a system where the ruler vows and make an oath to rule you with what Allah Azza wa Jalla has revealed, with the greatest possible justice being distributed to you. That is what the essence of political systems. You don't care in political systems about who gets power, who doesn't get power, who has authority, who doesn't. At the end of the day, what you care about is someone who implement just rules upon you. You need that. That is the structure of Islam. And the economy. The economy, you need the wealth distribution. You need a system where, like Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, كَيْلَا يَكُونَ دُولَةً بَيْنَ الْأَغْنِيَاءِ مِنْكُمْ. I want things to happen so that the money does not remain within the hands of those rich among you. كَيْلَا يَكُونَ دُولَةً بَيْنَ الْأَغْنِيَاءِ مِنْكُمْ. So the money, the wealth, does not remain in the hands of a few who are rich, just like what we have in the current systems in the world. So that is what an economic system is, that's what the structure is. Now, a psalm, the Prophet ﷺ says, a psalm is one of the pillars that hold the structure. Without it, without a psalm, we're not talking about a salah and a zakah and a hajj, because each of them has its own role, but a psalm has a role. As we already spoke earlier, one of the roles is to build the taqwa within you and within your rulers and within the people you deal with. A psalm has come to clean the hearts from within, to clean you from within, so you deal on a fair basis. Because quite often, what really disturbs the tranquility of a society is that people do not deal on a fair basis. People do not act naturally or with their pure, when I say naturally, I mean the fitrah. With the fitrah that Allah Azza wa Jalla has created the people with. Sometimes they have all these type of tricks and and deceptions and ill behavior, Islam has come to smoothen that out, to make the people a bit more closer to Allah, to make the taqwa, as we said at the beginning, and to be dependent on the Quran and Islam for guidance. When that is done, when a siyam comes and works on the people, so that the people, they behave and they interact in the society in a manner that allows the structure of Islam to be built and maintained. So a siyam, in this case, it acts on the leader. So the leader or the ruler is no longer corrupt. The ruler has taqwa, and therefore he has to implement justice. It acts on the world, on the people, so that the people will be good soldiers, good citizens, good obedient, abiding by the law people, people who abide by the laws of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So a psalm comes to build that general characteristic, as we talked about earlier, a taqwa, so that this whole structure becomes clear. Think of a household. Think of the household with a man, a woman, a wife, and the kids. If any of them, if the man goes gambling, and he doesn't have any cautious or any awareness or any alert for his family, then the house will collapse. If the woman is not caring about her husband or the kids, she doesn't care of the husband or the kids or the house, then the house will collapse. If one of the kids goes astray and becomes a bandit or someone who's always, you go to bear the mouth from jail, that makes the whole life of the whole house miserable. He breaks the unity of the house. So if you have something that works on these people, even inside a small house, to build their taqwa, to build their moral value, to build their alertness and awareness and care about one another, then the house starts becoming a bit more stronger, and the building of the whole house, the whole family, the whole unit becomes a bit more smoother. And that's the same as society. So a soul, when the Prophet ﷺ says, "Buniya Islam al-Qas," he means it. He means that this structure of Islam, once you have it, you have to maintain it, and you have to keep it up with those pillars. But for sure, the Prophet ﷺ did not want us to have the pillars gone. So I wanted to pay our attention, to draw our attention to this hadith, which we always quote, we frequently quote, "Buniya Islam al-Qas." Islam has been built upon five. Shahadat an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, iqam as-salah wa ita'u az-zakah wa hajj al-bayt wa sawm Ramadan. The prayer, the zakah, the hajj, and the sawm. So those things, and in particular as-sawm, is not meant by itself. It's not because as-sawm is meant per se. It's not the final objective. It is a means for something else. It's a means for the structure. So we have always to remind ourselves that this psalm has a value for the structure, has an objective to keep a structure. And when we don't have that structure, we are missing the whole point. If we don't have the structure, we don't build it, we don't keep it, and we don't live in it, that means we are living outside the scope of Islam. And so when Ramadan comes, every time Ramadan comes, always remember, this hadith, Buniya Islam, there is a structure of Islam that has to be there. If that structure is not there, just like today, today we don't have that structure. Today the Muslim Ummah lives without a structure. The Muslim Ummah lives outside the scope of the building of Islam. Because the building of Islam was destroyed. The Prophet ﷺ built a building. When he, now remember, As-Sawm was not ordained upon Muslim except in Medina, after the creation of the Islamic State in Medina. Same as Zakat, same as Hajj. The only thing that was ordained or became obligation before Medina was As-Salah. That's the only thing. Of course, the Shahadatain, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, and As-Salah. But As-Sawm, Zakat, Hajj, they came almost late, only later, after the migration to Medina. So the Sawm, Zakat, and Al-Hajj, they are tightly coupled, and very much related with the structure of Islam. And the Prophet ﷺ, the moment he stepped his foot in Medina, he started building that structure. Not the masjid. We always think of the masjid. The masjid was an important element of the structure of Islam, because it was his headquarters. Al-Masjid was the headquarters for Muhammad. It was an office from where he rules the people. Not only he needs the prayer, but that's where he used to initiate the armies, that's where he used to initiate the acts, that's where he used to do the judgment between people, that's where he used to teach the people. So it's his office. It's his main office. It's his headquarters. So he built the masjid, meaning he built a headquarters for the leader of the state, for the man of the structure, for the person who maintains the whole structure, which was Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After his death, it was maintained by Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and then by Umar, and then by Uthman, and then by Ali. And they used to be called the successors. One succeeds the next one. And they were successors for khulafa, not for prophethood, but successors with the ruling. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in one hadith says, كانت بنو إسرائيل تسوسهم الأنبياء كلما هلك نبي خلفه نبي. بني إسرائيل, they used to be ruled by prophets. Whenever a prophet dies, another prophet will take over. إلا أنه لا نبي بعد. But after I die, there will be no prophet. ولكن, however, ستكون خلفاء فتكثر. However, there will be successors, there will be خليفة, and there will be many. And the Sahaba, they asked the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, what should we do with these? He said, فوق بيعة الأول فالأول, you fulfill the allegiance for them one after another. One after another. Take their allegiance and make sure they will fulfill it. That's how the structure of Islam was maintained. That's how the structure of Islam was maintained, and it continued to exist for so many years, for so many decades, for so many centuries. Until recently, in almost 90 years ago, Mustafa Kemal in Turkey, he destroyed that structure. He took it out. And once he took it out, since that time, the Muslims live outside the structure of Islam. We live with the pillars only. We have our salah, we have our song, we have our zakah, we have our hajj. Alhamdulillah, we have these pillars, but we don't have the structure. We don't have the social system in Islam. We don't have the judicial system. Most of them, all the Muslim countries, you go to the court system has the civil code that was imported from Britain or France, or both. All, without exception. The civil code, which is implemented in the court systems, now the court systems, they have dual court system. They have Sharia court and civil court. The Sharia court is for some rules of inheritance, and the civil court is for all other problems, imported from Britain or France. That's a fact. All the Muslim countries, well, the economic system which is implemented is capitalism. We don't have the rules of property, the rules of ownership, the rules which prevent the river. Those ones don't exist. The rules of corporations, the rules of investments, all of these rules are not Islamic. So we don't even have that structure. We don't have the political structure. Political structure where there's a khalifa, there's imam, there are mu'awareen, there are judicial system in Islam, there is a shura system that does not exist either. So the structure of Islam has been eliminated. What is left in reality are only the pillars. And as I mentioned at the beginning, none of us will accept to live one day in a house without a ceiling or without walls. None. Not even refugees. If the refugee or the person who doesn't have a home, he will go and live under a tree. He will find a tree and live under a tree. Or he will go to a cave. But he will never accept to live in a house with pillars on. And then, think where I put it right after the structure of value, because it rhymes, it flows. One of the values it has. It has the value of the structure, as I said. Keeps you thinking that we have to build a structure because it's a pillar, so we don't have a pillar without a structure. And then specifically, it comes the political, and I wanted from the political the concept of unity. The concept of unity. Now, note that in Ramadan, quite often, for many years, this year is a little bit different, but even this year, people fast on different days. even in the Muslim world. Forget about between America or West and the East, when they say there are two different locations of the earth. But we are talking about people between like Syria and Iraq, Syria and Turkey, Turkey and Iran, those are Muslim countries, and the people, they fast on different days. Now that reflects the disunity of the Ummah. It immediately pinpoints. Now of course we know the Ummah is disunited. The Ummah is disunited because there are borders. It's a fracture. You have a border, you have imaginary borders between Syria and Jordan, between Jordan and Iraq, between Jordan and Saudi Arabia, between Pakistan. Now of course Bangladesh, there's a whole subcontinent between Pakistan and Bangladesh, between Pakistan, Kashmir, the Indian Kashmir, between Pakistan, Afghanistan, between Afghanistan and Uzbekistan. All of these divisions, we know them. But then Ramadan comes, and immediately, the first day of Ramadan, it throws it in your face that, man, we cannot fast on the same day. And Eid comes, we do not celebrate it on the same day. And that hurts. That provides this type of feeling, that emotion, that even the ibadah, even the psalm, which is something as to Allah Azza wa Jalla, psalm riwayat ZB, even this psalm, we cannot fast on the same day, not because there is a difference in fiqh, not because we are different moon-sighted, because what difference in moon-sighted could be between Jordan and Syria, between Syria and Turkey? Those are the same borders, it's the same location. What, even if it was like the two countries, then sometimes are split in the same city. Part of the city in this country and part of the city in the other country. It's one city. This part fasts on Friday and this one on Saturday. So that issue, you immediately see, our disunity has come so deep, has been so deep that it has affected and impacted our soul. It has gripped into our ibadah. Just like they say, in the past, in old days, there was a time duration, not very long, where Muslims, they used to pray in the masjid four different prayers, jama'ah. This is a jama'ah for Imam Shafi'i, this is a jama'ah for Abu Hanifa, this is a jama'ah for Abu Hanbal, this is a jama'ah of Malik. It went for about a couple of years before the Imam came and they said, stop this nonsense, and he stopped it, and he ordered if more than jama'ah will take place in the masjid, he will punish everyone else. It's not allowed. Then the people forgot about it. So their salah sometimes, your salah, or today there's people talking about hajj, sometimes, remember our hajj, or when the people may celebrate their Eid on different days. Some people, they were contemplating the idea of standing on Arafah on a different day. Now, of course, Saudi Arabia is so far strong, will not allow that. But imagine if the Saudi government becomes weak, or there will become a chaos. You will have two Arafah or three Arafah. So that disunity is directly impacting or hitting our ibadah. And so it really shows, and it hurts. So Psalm comes not to disunite Muslims. A Psalm does not disunite. A Psalm shows the disunity of the Ummah. So because sometimes the people say, oh, even a Psalm is disuniting us. Even a Psalm or Ramadan is not uniting the Ummah. Ramadan does not unite the Ummah. Ramadan shows the unity of the Ummah or the disunity of the Ummah. So if the Ummah is united, so if we have one Ummah, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam meant it, he said, وَإِنَّ أُمَّةَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ أُمَّةٌ مِنْ دُونِ النَّاسِ. When he signed the treaty between the Jews, which they call it the first constitution of Islam, drafted by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he outlined the duties and the roles between the Muslims and the Jews around the Medina, and he says, الْمُسْلِمُونَ أُمَّةٌ مِنْ دُونِ النَّاسِ. The Muslims are ummah, different from all the people. He says, the Muslims, ummah. He did not say the Muslims of Medina, or the Muslims of Mecca, although they were in Medina still. But when more countries, more places were annexed to the Islamic State, Mecca, Khaybar, Taif later, and then Tabuk, they became part of the Islamic State, all of them became part of this Ummah. المسلمون أمة من دون الناس. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وأن هذه أمتكم أمة واحدة. This ummah is one ummah for Islam. And he says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. All of you hold the rope of Allah Azza wa Jalla. There is one rope for Allah. There are no two ropes. You cannot be holding a rope of Pakistani Desi, or a rope of Arab, or a rope of Turks, and then the rope of Islam. We don't have two ropes in Islam. There is only one rope that we all hold to. So Islam, the Muslim Ummah, must be united. That's to be united. And if it's not united, if it is disunited, if it's fractured, if the political disunity is there, then that will be reflected on us all. So that's why every year when we have a Sawm, there the disputes all over the world, what day we are going to start Ramadan, simply because this Ummah is not an Ummah. It's not one Ummah. Now think about it. Any of the countries, take Pakistan for example. When the Mufti in Pakistan or the Qadi says, Saturday is Ramadan, it's over for all the people inside that country. Now imagine that Pakistan was a little bit expanded into half of Afghanistan and into Kashmir. So Kashmir was part of Pakistan, and inshallah it will be. And Afghanistan was with Pakistan simply. And then the Mufti or the Qadi will say, Saturday is Ramadan. Do you think some people in the Afghan part of the Pushto will say, we are not fasting on this day? If the Mufti, not even the president of the country, the Mufti says, today is Ramadan, or Saturday is Ramadan, all the people who are under the umbrella of that Mufti will say, okay, we'll start. But if there is a border, an imaginary border, you have two Muftis, one Mufti says Friday and one Mufti says Saturday, then we have two Ramadans, correct? Same location.
Actually, it does happen even now in Pakistan. Sometimes Peshawar, a part of Pakistan, they have different day, and Karachi is a different. Even in Pakistan, they
even inside the place, because the Mufti doesn't have this power.
There are two. That's right.
Even inside the first, and go to the Middle East, the same. So the idea here is, when Ramadan comes, and we fast on a different day, it has to hit our hand immediately. That disunity has to stop.
Yeah.
Now, the reason I'm saying this is because the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is obvious. He wanted the people to fast on the same day. The Prophet ﷺ wanted the people to fast on the same day. He did not want people to fast on different days. In fact, from the hadith, which is, it is quoted sometimes for to argue on behalf of the so-called ikhtilaf al-mataala, the difference al-mataala. When he says, the Ramadan for us is 29 days, and we do not read or write, we just go by the sighting. Now, this hadith can be understood in many different ways, but the most simplest way, it is saying, forget about these calculations, just fast on the same day, just fast. Make it just first on the day when somebody cites the one. Whether it's the calculation or not the calculation, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wanted the people to fast on Monday. That's how the Khulafa proceeded after him. In fact, during the, and this is in the documented in the history, during the Abbasi era, because remember the Bani Umayyah, their state spread very large, but they were very much involved in the wars. So the Abbasids are the ones who enjoyed the benefits of a large state. You all remember Harun al-Rashid, when he used to joke with the cloud. He said, oh cloud, you are not going to reign in Baghdad? Fine, go and reign wherever you want. Because your kharaj, your fruits are coming back to me. Just joking with the cloud, but he's a powerful statesman. So that state used to be, I would call it the state that benefits or enjoys the goodies of a large Islamic state. What did they do in order to unify the day of fasting? The order of the Khalifa was, whoever sights the moon anywhere, he should build a big fire, a large fire, so it will be visible for long distance. And whoever sees the fire, he shall light another fire. so that the next people would see it. So within probably minutes of someone is watching the moon or seeing the moon in the state, fires would be lit all over the country, from the east all the way to the west, from the north to the south. The only, probably if there's an ocean, and there was no ocean separating the Islamic State then, except in Andalus, Andalus wouldn't, probably the Andalus even they would see the light in Morocco, because it's very, very tight. So the idea that they created, they invented this to propagate the moon sighting at the speed of light, because fire is light. Huge fire, the fire would be visible at the speed of light. Once the big fire is seen, within seconds, people maybe 15 or 20 miles away would see it. And those people who are 15 or 20 miles would have another light, and then it would travel the same distance. So within a couple of hours, people would find out. So it was even to that extent, they were keen about people knowing about the moon, because that reflects the unity of this thing. So when I talk about here this political value that Ramadan comes and it reminds us that, all Muslims, you are in a very desperate situation. Very desperate. Just like the hadith, the first one, Bunya Islam wa ala khams. Ramadan, al-Siyam, is a pillar for a structure. You don't have a structure. What a pity. Siyam, you should be Muslims first on the same day. At least those within the same big mukarrab, at least. You are not. What a pity. So Ramadan comes and reminds of this fact. And that reminder is not just to make us sad, as the brother was asking, what do we do about it? Is that something that we just say, oh, okay, subhanAllah, we are disunited? No. That is something that we will be responsible for. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Quran, He makes it a duty. He says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا. This ayah, all you who believe, fear Allah or not fear Allah, اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ, because I use the word اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ, beware Allah, the way He should be, the way He should be aware of, you should be aware of Him, the way you should be aware of Him. وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ, never die not Muslims. So if you are not watching Allah Azza wa Jalla carefully, that means you are not dying as Muslims. وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. And then he says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا, all of you hold to the rope of Allah. That's an order. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, and do not disperse, do not disunite. So when Allah Azza wa Jalla wants an issue to be very precise and very strong, He always gives the order to do and the opposite. Like the Iman, Shahadatayn, La ilaha illallah. You negate all gods and you establish one God, Allah. So whenever the issue is very serious, Allah Azza wa Jalla uses this technique in the Quran, or this style, that negates and makes an order, or makes an order and negates the opposite. اعتصموا ولا تفرقوا. Because sometimes you say, it's enough to say unite. He says, no, no, no. Unite and do not disunite. Just to make sure that you don't miss it. In science and technology, we say necessary and sufficient condition. It's necessary and sufficient. Two conditions, two things should happen so that you make sure you are united. اعتصموا بحبل الله ولا تفرقوا. And by the way, this ayah was revealed in the occasion when some Muslims were dispersed in Medina. The Jews, they played game trick among the Muslims and they wanted them to split and fight. So the Prophet ﷺ warned them, and the Quran was revealed to tell that you have to be united and it's haram for you to be disunited. So Ramadan comes, it reminds us that, look, you are disunited, so we are not fulfilling an order. There's an order that we are not fulfilling. يَعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ جَمِيعًا. And there is a haram we are doing, which is التَّفَرُّقُ وَلَا التَّفَرُّقُ. So this Ramadan should tell us, it's not that we fight, we argue about fiqh. We sit for many hours to say, what is the good rule or bad rule? The other day I was asked this question in one masjid. So that's irrelevant, what rule. issue. The issue is, you fast on Friday, I fast on Saturday, he fast on Sunday, we are disunited, it is haram. The disunity is haram, it's not allowed. Doesn't matter why, doesn't matter how, but it is a haram, so the Muslims have to build the structure, a united structure. A one union, a one unit for all the Ummah, and the only way you can be one Ummah is if you have one Imam of the Ummah. And there are hadiths on this issue. Ramadan has been famous in the history of Islam to be the month in which decisive histories, decisive victories and battles, they took place. Like the Battle of Badr. Badr, remember, Badr was the first ever battle fought in Islam and it was a victory for Islam. It was in the, on the 17th day of Ramadan. The conquest of Mecca was also in Ramadan. On the 20th day of Ramadan, that's when the actual movement of the army of Islam began launching and marching towards Mecca. So it was in Ramadan. And Allah Azza wa Jalla called it the great fatih, the great conquest. And when the Crusaders took Palestine and the majority of the Middle East for so many years, the decisive battle of Hattin was on the 10th day of Ramadan. Was in Ramadan. In the Mongols, when they were defeated finally in the battle of Ain Jalut at the hand of the leader Qutuz Abdullah al-Baybars, it was on Ramadan as well. So those, and there are many others, in fact, there is the battle of called Barat al-Shuhada or Poté in France, which was by Abdurrahman al-Ghafiqi, the one of the biggest battles, which was almost the whole history of Europe would have been changed, was also in Ramadan. So Ramadan had always been a month of great victories. So, and today when the Muslims think of Ramadan, and when Ramadan comes, they should think again that the victories that they are waiting for, the victories in uniting the Muslims, the victories in liberating Palestine, the victories in liberating Afghanistan, in liberating Kashmir, in liberating Myanmar or Burma, the Muslims there, in liberating Muslims in East Europe. All of these, or in China, the Western China, I think they have a name for the
Xinjiang.
So when we talk about all of these, they do remind us of the need for Ramadan to be one more time a month of victory. And again, for Ramadan to be a month of victory is exactly just to be the month of unity, is exactly to be the month of the structure. So all of these, they come together and we are reminded by them that this historic values, and they are very important. And when we talk about history, especially for our young kids who read history, history is not a light thing, it's not something small. The reason they teach history, and they insist on teaching history in classes, especially for school, and even in colleges. In colleges, most of the colleges, they have requirements of history. You have to take history classes. You have to understand the history of the country. Why? Because history provides a wealth of heritage. It gives this momentum that I am not only a person of today, I'm not only a person of the present, I do have a past. And any person who has a past, even sometimes a family past, if you, in your ancestors, you know there was, oh, my great-grandfather was a scholar, that sometimes is good enough or strong enough to push you to follow the scholarship, to be a scholar. If your family heritage, if your father, your grandfather, great-grandfather, all of them were scholars, then you want to be one of them as well. You will be a continuation of that. So history, when history is great, it always gives you that this advantage that you should have a continuation. So Ramadan comes, if you go to Google and scan the days, the good days in Ramadan, you will find tens of them. Tens of Ramadan days which have been days of great victory. So only Ramadan by itself, the days, the great days of Ramadan, are more than enough to provide you a rich history, a heritage that allows you to always look back to be at least as victorious, as productive as you were in Ramadan. Now, just to mention a story on how important heritage is. I remember I was once in a meeting in Malaysia with the president of the Islamic University, and he was talking about how his leader at the time, Mahathir Muhammad, he was trying to look and see how can Malaysia progress. And he was touring the world instead of touring Islam and looking for Islam at the time. But he was trying to see the models of Korea, the model of Ireland, United States, Japan, and so on. So in Korea, he says, he asked the Prime Minister of Korea, what is it that you utilize the most in order to motivate the people of Korea to be so productive and to be so prosperous? And the guy, the Prime Minister, tells this, the Malaysians, delegate, says, when we were searching in order to find ways to progress, we looked at our history. We looked at our history to find some great days, something that we can give to the Korean people to push them so that to be proud of something. And we found maybe 2,000 years ago, the Koreans were able to defeat China in one of the wars. One day, in their history, and he said, we made a big deal out of that day. We put it in our history books, all over, from the kindergarten all the way to school, just about that day of victory, that day of victory. We put all the slogans, all the posters, so people feel proud of that. And that had a great impact on the morality, on the morale of the people. Now, imagine, now the guy was telling us, he says, Mahathir Muhammad gave the story, he wrote in his notebook, says, oh, we have hundreds like these days. Hundreds like this, so that's, we are not short of these days, but we are short of using them. We are short. So when we go and look at better words of Ramadan, we have to emphasize it. Like the day of Badr, everybody should be talking about it. Everybody should be talking about Badr, the greatest of Badr, the decisive victory of Badr. When it comes to the 20th of Ramadan, everybody should be talking about Mecca. Everybody should be talking about the conquest of Mecca and making a story about it. And how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered Mecca, how he was making takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, just like the takbir of Eid. Everybody should be making a big issue out of it. It is a big. When it comes to the 10th of Ramadan, everybody should be talking about Hattin, how Salah al-Din was able to liberate Jerusalem from the Crusaders. When it comes to the day like the Qutuz was able to liberate or to kick the Mughals back from Ain Jalut, everybody should be talking about Ain Jalut. This is a day of Islam, this is a day of greatness, this is a day of Ramadan. So Ramadan in itself, it has that full history, that big impact. And this can have impact on our kids, on our youngs, on our people, because the more you talk about your history, now quite often in most of our countries, we have the so-called Independence Day, National Independence or Flag Day. It's most of the time, it's not even independence, it's junk day. We say we have got independence from Britain, we are still under the surveillance of Britain and America. Jordan got the independence from Britain until today. The ambassador of Britain still rules Jordan. We got independence from France in Algeria until today. The French generals still order them. So, and we still make a big issue out of these days. Those days, they cannot move a single beat of our hearts. Those so-called national days, they don't even make our eyes blink. They just pass and they make parades out of them. They are nonsense. They don't make, they don't touch our feelings. But the real ones that touch our feelings, for some reason, they are avoided. And that's what we should be looking at. something which you inherit from the past. Imagine you inherit $1 million from your parents. Man, you'd be so happy. Now we are inheriting more than billions from our ancestors. We've inherited, and those inheritance were documented, some of them in the Quran. Like the Battle of Badr was documented in the Quran, the Battle of Mecca was documented in the Quran. Going back to the Quran to Bayinat min al-Huda wa al-Furqan. So it's not only documented in books of history, which we never know whether they are correct or incorrect, how good they are, but they are documented in our Quran. And they are documented in the books of Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they are documented in the books of Sirah. And they are documented in the books of history of Islam, which are some of the most authentic history books ever. The Muslim history books, like Al-Tabari, like Ibn Kathir, you cannot find any recent history books which are more authentic than these people. Because these people, they authenticate by all means. Today, if you read any book, history about the US history or French history, it's probably one writer, one person who wrote something and he doesn't even have any good references. I'm talking about history, not the current ones. So those historical value of Ramadan, we should not take it lightly, because that is a heritage. That's something you inherit from your ancestors, and people achieved great victories. Those, they should be emphasized. And sometimes when I see the month of the Battle of Badr comes and goes, and I go to a Jum'ah, and the Khatib for some reason ignores it or does not talk about it, I feel a little bit irritated. When the month of Ramadan comes and goes, and you don't see every Jum'ah, every talk, someone is bringing an issue about Mecca, about Qiyam, about Ain Jalut, about Badr, about all of these battles, it makes you feel that why we are not so proud of our history. Our history is good. It's big. It's strong. It's nice. It's delightful. It's victorious. We should be proud of it. Sometimes, as I mentioned, they push you to be proud of a day that you cannot be even proud of, especially in the Muslim world, those so-called independence days, flag days, the day when Britain gave us flags to the Middle East. They gave each king, this is your flag, this is your army, this is your prison. And we celebrate this, and they push our kids to celebrate. But in reality, our history is much, much, much more rich than this. And that's the historic value of Ramadan. So Ramadan has this historic value. Jazakallah.